Welcome to the beginning of the winter season and the time of celebration. Let's stand together. Omitting verses 4 and 5, let's sing the procession of 450. Begins on page 299 in the Book of Common Prayer. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit,
and blessed be God's kingdom now and forever.
Amen. There is one body and one spirit.
There is one hope in God's call to us.
One Lord, one faith, one baptism.
One God and Father of all.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, whose will it is to restore all things in your well-beloved Son, the King of kings and the Lord of lords, mercifully grant that the peoples of the earth, divided and enslaved by sin, may be freed and brought together under his most gracious rule, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated for the first reading from Scripture.
A reading from the prophet Jeremiah. Woe to the shepherds who destroy and scatter the sheep of my pasture, says the Lord. Therefore, thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, concerning the shepherds who shepherd my people. It is you who have scattered my flock and have driven them away, and you have not attended to them. So I will attend to you for your evil doings, says the Lord. Then I myself will gather the remnant of my flock out of all the lands where I have driven them, and I will bring them back to their fold, and they shall be fruitful and multiply. I will raise up shepherds over them who will shepherd them, and they shall not fear any longer or be dismayed, nor shall any be missing, says the Lord. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will raise up for David a righteous branch, and he shall reign as king and deal wisely, and shall execute justice and righteousness in the land. In his days Judah will be saved, and Israel will live in safety, and this is the name by which he will be called: the Lord is our righteousness. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand and say together today's appointed psalm, found in your Sunday bulletin. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore we will not fear, though the earth be moved, and though the mountains be toppled into the depths of the sea, though its waters rage and foam, though the mountains tremble at its tumult. The Lord of hosts is with us, the God of Jacob is our stronghold. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy habitation of the Most High. God is in the midst of her, and she shall not be overthrown. God shall help her at the break of day. The nations make much ado, and the kingdoms are shaken. God has spoken, and the earth shall melt away. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our stronghold. Come now and look upon the works of the Lord, what awesome things he has done on earth. It is he who makes war to cease in all the world. He breaks the bow and shatters the spear and burns the shields with fire. Be still then and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our stronghold.
Please be seated for the reading of the epistle.
A reading from the letter to the Colossians. May you be made strong with all the strength that comes from his glorious power, and may you be prepared to endure everything with patience, while joyfully giving thanks to the Father, who has enabled you to share in the inheritance of the saints in the light. He has rescued us from the power of darkness and transferred us into the kingdom of his beloved Son, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For in him all things in heaven and on earth were created, things visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or powers. All things have been created through him and for him. He himself is before all things, and in him all things hold together. He is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, so that he might come to have the first place in everything. For in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him God was pleased to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, by making peace through the blood of his cross. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Let us stand together and sing the sequence hymn 433.
Thank you.
Gospel of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, according to St. Luke. Glory to you, Lord Christ. When they came to the place that is called the Skull, they crucified Jesus there with the criminals, one on his right and one on his left. Then Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." And they cast lots to divide his clothing, and the people stood by, watching Jesus on the cross. But the leaders scoffed at him, saying, "He saved others. Let him save himself if he's the Messiah of God, his chosen one." The soldiers also mocked him, coming up and offering him sour wine, and saying, "If you are the King of the Jews, save yourself." And there was also an inscription over him, "This is the King of the Jews." One of the criminals who were hanged there kept deriding Jesus and saying, "Are you not the Messiah? Then save yourself and us." But the other rebuked him, saying, "Do you not fear God, since you are under the same sentence of condemnation? And we indeed have been condemned justly, for we are getting what we deserve for our deeds, but this man has done nothing wrong." And then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." And Jesus replied, "Truly, I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise." This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Christ. Dear God, give us the courage and the grace to make known to those yet unborn and to those around us the saving deeds that God has done. Amen. Amen. Please be seated. Okay, I know. It's not Good Friday. It's Sunday morning. It's late in November. We got the snow and the ice to prove that it is exactly late in November here in New England and right before Thanksgiving. So why in the world do we have to hear about the crucifixion of Jesus Christ as the gospel reading on this particular Sunday of the year? Why can't we just talk about, you know, things like pilgrims? Why can't we talk about, you know, the blessings of the bountiful earth and the fragrance of hot turkey and, you know, and grape pies cooking in the kitchen? Why can't we focus just today on the blessings of life and generosity and interdependence that were exemplified on the first Thanksgiving morning, and then just wrap up this nice morning message with something quick and profound, like, "And let us pray that more and more in our world and in our time, we will move forward with such spirit," you know, and then just say amen, you know, and leave it at that. Why in the world the reading of the crucified Lord on this day, especially at St. Matt's, and especially when we're baptizing this wonderful child, you know, why the buzzkill? You know, that's the question. Well, you can take that one to the Standing Liturgical Commission of the Episcopal Church, all right? But actually, there are some really good reasons for that. First off, it's not Thanksgiving yet. It is not. Thursday is Thanksgiving. And St. Matthew's always offers a very nice and simple and I think profound, quiet Holy Communion service here at 10 o'clock every Thanksgiving, through thick and thin, with Thanksgiving readings and Thanksgiving prayers. And yes, a short and reverent Thanksgiving message from yours truly. So that's one good reason. Secondly, next Sunday, December 1st, is the first Sunday of Holy Advent. Of Holy Advent is the start of a brand new year in the church that looks forward to the coming of Christ anew. And given that, you need to realize then, of course, that means this Sunday, today, is the very last Sunday of the Christian year. And therefore, it's extremely important for us to say something about what the last day means for people of faith in Christ. Is the last day going to be a day of defeat, you know, or is it going to be a day of the victory of the love of God? And that's, you have to decide who you are and whose you are on the last day. And Thirdly, in a very rare move and confluence of, I think, grace, our new bishop, Rob Hirschfeld, asked all the other bishop equivalents of all the other denominations in the state of New Hampshire to join with us today and to ask to, and to preach to their people about the evils of state-sponsored execution. And they are all doing it today. This has not happened. I've been here in 29 years, and that's never happened. That we're all these great people and leaders are in agreement on something, and this is it. This is it, the evils of state-sponsored execution. And you know, there's no more fitting example of the horror of state-sponsored execution in all the world than the crucifixion of Jesus Christ. In the United States, in the last 40 years, 130 people have been convicted of murder and facing the death sentence. And of those 130, thank God, had their convictions overturned before they were executed in our names and with our tax dollars and by our state. Unfortunately, in the last 40 years, at least 8 souls have been executed in this country with strong evidence of their innocence discovered later, right? Discovered too little, too late, absolutely a shame and a sin. And if that were not enough to convince or at least spark within one that state-sponsored execution is immoral and that it is absolutely flawed in its application and, by the way, totally against everything that Jesus Christ stood for or taught in his life. You know, little things like thou shalt not kill and never, ever return evil for the evil done for you or to you and turn the other cheek in the face of violence. Well, we know in our nation that actually a disproportionate number of non-white and poor people get the death penalty for the same or lesser charges than their white and often, you know, people of better resources, white people. Speaking of money and the death penalty. And by the way, I don't think we should have to even offer the monetary argument, but unfortunately, well, that seems to be what appeals. Speaking of money and the death penalty, you know that on average, it costs $30 million to execute one human being. $30 million on average to execute one person. That is 10 times the amount that it costs to incarcerate somebody for 100 years in the highest security prison in the land. Okay? So that ought to at least start the juices flowing. Here in New Hampshire, by the way, where far-right conservatives say they're so protective of our tax dollars, and you know they hate to do it, but they, you know, we really need to cut back on our aid to the poor and the sick and on education to our kids. For some reason, these same guys they prove they're not fiscal conservatives at all, because they're more than willing to explore creative ways to find the $4 million that it will cost to build a death chamber for New Hampshire. Why? Because we don't have one. And since the 1880s, our legislators, our reps, have been saying we don't want one. And if our Lord were standing here today before you, he would certainly be saying, and we sure don't need one. Okay, all right, the rant is over. You can breathe, you know, or whatever you want to do. But the reason for this particular emphasis on this Sunday, the last day, as, you know, as we, to quote the great John Donne, as we hang with the man who hung on the cross for you and for me and for that man who made his confession and his repentance at the last second of his life, as we hang with the man who hung on the cross, as we worship in the name of the healer of nations and the lover of souls, you need to understand, and I hope rejoice, that finally, come January, there's going to be a bill in the New Hampshire legislature calling for the abolition of the death penalty once and for all, and it has a really good chance of passing, I'm happy to say. This bill is being drafted by a state representative. His name is Rennie Cushing. He's a wonderful guy whose father was murdered in cold blood, premeditated cold blood, here in New Hampshire a few years ago. And Rennie does not ever want to see another person, not even a guilty person, die by premeditated murder like his father did, and certainly not at the hands of his state, and certainly not in his name, because the state acts for you, and certainly not with his tax dollars supporting such an act. Okay, really, now I'm done, okay? I'm really done. But if you want more, join the coalition, the New Hampshire Coalition, to abolish the death penalty. Look them up. Or talk to me about the Episcopal Peace Fellowship that's been working on this for decades here and nationwide. Now, on the last day, in the end, you and I need to account for ourselves, right? As civilized human beings. But more importantly, we're going to need to account for ourselves as faithful human beings, as people of God, baptized in Christ. And, you know, in just a minute, we are going to stand here with this brand new, beautiful baby girl and her parents and her grandparents, and we are going to make promises, you know, on her behalf, that we are going to do all in our power to help her grow into the stature of Christ. Stature of Christ. And that's her job, and that's our job to nurture, and it's your job to grow that way too. We will also say that we are going to respect the dignity of every human being. That's part of our baptismal vow. We are going to say that we will seek and serve Christ in all persons, yes, the innocent, but also the guilty. And yes, we will proclaim by word and example, good news of God in Christ. That's our baptismal vow. That's who we are, because we belong to God. Now, this child about to be baptized, all God's children, and all of us need to know that at the end of the day, on the last day, in the end, that the victory of Christ, that's all about ongoing faith. It's about the process of love unfolding in this world that leads to people restored, to a world redeemed and made whole and full, finally, once more. Our children and our grandchildren, they need to know that somebody in the world affirms this. And it's not somebody else, my friends. It's people of Christ who affirm this. And that somebody is you and me. And today, know that throughout the state, the whole Christian community is onto this, and it's a wonderful thing, wonderful thing. May our song be something to the tune of the one who Jesus welcomed into God's kingdom at the 11th hour, the man who said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Remember me when you come into your kingdom." And may our children come to know of God's limitless love too, a love and a power that includes all of them, at every stage of life, no matter what. So yeah, I know, it's not Good Friday. In fact, this is the last Sunday of the Christian year, and it's called Christ the King Day. Christ the King of Kings, Lord of Lords, is in the victory of light over darkness, of God's life and love over our propensities for retribution and for death. That's right, in the end, we owe it. We owe it to our kids to extend and never presume to limit the saving power of Christ. So pray that by our witness and Christ's sacrifice, that the crucifixions will finally cease and that the healing will come. And that will be a day for real thanksgiving. Amen. Will the parents and godparents of young Kiva please come forward? Will the people please turn to page 301 in the Book of Common Prayer?
Stand.
For the bottom of page 303, it's our turn to make vows on behalf of this child of Christ. Will you who witness these vows do all in your power to support this child in her life in Christ?
Amen.
Then let us join with this child being committed to Christ and renew our baptismal covenant. Do you believe in God the Father?
I believe in God the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God?
I believe in Jesus Christ, the only Son of our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He descended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead.
Do you believe in God, the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Will you continue in the apostles' teaching and the fellowship and the breaking of bread and in the prayers?
I will, with God's help.
Will you persevere in resisting evil and, whenever you fall into sin, repent and return to the Lord?
I will, with God's help.
Will you proclaim by word and example the good news of God in Christ?
I will, with God's help.
Will you seek and serve Christ in all persons, loving your neighbor as yourself?
I will, with God's help.
Will you strive for justice and peace among all people and respect the dignity of every human being?
I will, with God's help.
Then let us now pray for this child who is to receive the sacrament of new birth.
Deliver her, O Lord, from the way of sin and death.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Open her heart to grace and truth.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Fill her with your holy and life-giving spirit.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Keep her in the faith and communion of your holy church.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Teach her to love others in the power of the Spirit.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Send her to the world and witness to your love.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Bring her to the fullness of your peace.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord, as we are also offering our prayers to you, hear our prayer for your church and its mission in the world, for our presiding Bishop Catherine and our Bishop Rob, and hear our prayers for healing for those for whom the prayers of this parish have been asked today, for Diane, Alona, Jasmine, John and Dane, for Aaron, Anna, Michael, Joshua, and Randy, for Rick, for Leslie and Skylar, for Matt, Riley, Mary Claire, Judith Ann, Cynthia, and Moira, and for those in our hearts today. And let us offer our thanksgivings for the blessings in our life, for the year's harvest and all blessings, the great efforts of the Network Food Pantry staff and volunteers delivering Thanksgiving support for at least 450 people this past weekend, the baptism of young Kiva Penn, and her family, for the anniversaries of those known to us this week of Ted and Star Coulter and John and Dale Fite, for Don and Alice Kouchner. And let us also pray for those who have gone before us to their reward. From our book of remembrance today, we remember Douglas Wyman, Jack and Don, for Catherine Veronica Fisher, and for Duncan Simon Sr. and Ted Rohr, in whose loving memory the altar flowers and cornucopia are given today. Grant, O Lord, that all who are baptized into the death of Jesus Christ, your Son, may live in the power of his resurrection and look for him to come again in glory, who lives and reigns now and forever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
We thank you, Almighty God, for the gift of water. Over it, the Holy Spirit moved in the beginning of creation, and through it, you led the children of Israel out of their bondage in Egypt into the land of promise. And in it, your Son Jesus received the baptism of John and was anointed by the Holy Spirit as the Messiah, the Christ, to lead us through his death and resurrection in the bondage of sin and everlasting life. We thank you, Father, for the water of baptism. In it we are buried with Christ in his death. By it we share in his resurrection, and through it we are reborn by the Holy Spirit. Therefore, in joyful obedience to your Son, we bring into his fellowship those who come to him with faith, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. And now, baptize and sanctify this water, we pray you, by the power of your Spirit, that those who are here cleansed from sin and born anew may continue forever in the risen life of Jesus Christ our Savior. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit, be all honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. An overdose of heat. King of Barry Iverson, I've got to tell you in the name of God the Father, your Creator, and God the Son, your Redeemer, and God the Holy Spirit, your Sustainer. Amen. King of Barry Iverson, you are sealed by the Holy Spirit in baptism, and you are marked as Christ of you forever. Amen. Toward the bottom of page 308, let us welcome the newly baptized by saying together, we receive you in the bottom of the soul of God,
confess the faith of Christ crucified, proclaim his resurrection, and share with us his eternal priesthood.
May the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Thanksgiving morning, there's a 10 o'clock, very simple, spoken, holy communion,
service here, and I recommend that to you as well. I think the other announcements are pretty self-explanatory unless anybody else has any. You good? Leo, you have one. Dave, you want to go first? Dave,
you can go. Saturday, 10 a.m. to noon is the church cleanup and preparation for Advent season, so if you can come by and give us some time to help spruce things up in preparation for Advent, we appreciate it.
And that's 10 to noon. What do? We polish the brass. We make sure the pews are just slippery, we do greens, and we build a quick Advent wreath with our youth as well. So, come on ahead. We'd love to have you. Okay, and Leo, you might want to come forward for this one.
So the St. Matthew's Photo Directory Project is underway. The forms for updating the fan information before we get a photo directory and update the way we store records about the prisoners that's ongoing. So please, if you can complete those forms and get them back to the office. And you'll be able to submit your own photos if you want, but if you don't have a recent photo that you like, we're going to be taking photos next Sunday, after sure, and Sunday following, both at 10 a.m. next. So, dress up and show up. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Thanks. And thanks to professional photographer George Loves, who was volunteered to take those photos for you. Yeah, Joan?
St. Matthew's Christmas cards will be on sale during coffee hour downstairs, so come get them before they stop.
There you go. All people of faith are welcome and encouraged to receive communion at the Lord's table, and we offer to God a sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Notice that word again. Do you know that the word Eucharist, Holy Eucharist, in Greek, the translation of that is thanksgiving. We have gathered a thanksgiving table of God every week. You are all welcome to do so. We give your vows to the Most High.
Jesus, let us drink the mountain sound.
thanksgiving. The Eucharistic prayer is on page 361 in the Book of Common Prayer. The Lord be with you.
And also
with you. Lift up your hearts.
Lift
them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right
and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, because in Jesus Christ our Lord you have received us as your sons and daughters, made us citizens of your kingdom, and given us the Holy Spirit to guide us into all truth. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you and for all for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit, to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace, and at the last day bring us with the King of Kings and with Miss Kiva and all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen." Alleluia. Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the peace. Alleluia. purpose of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ gave himself for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Amen.
Thank you.
The post-communion prayer of thanksgiving is found at the bottom of page 365 in the Book of Common Prayer. Let us pray together. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. And you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart through Christ our Lord. Amen. Before I give the final blessing, I would invite you to feel free to pick up a copy of the bishop's letter, which is on the entry table, and for your edification and to see what our bishops are thinking these days. And now, go forth into the world in peace. Be strong and of good courage. Hold fast to that which is good, rejoicing in the power of God's Spirit. And may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among us now and remain with us always. Amen. The recessional hymn omitting verse 4 is hymn 494.